Neki od starosjedilačkih naroda imaju izreke poput izreke Čiroki Indijanaca koja glasi: nije li dobro za sve, uopće nije dobro. Taj se princip u Africi naziva Ubuntu. Ubuntu je bio temelj na kojem je Michael Tellinger razvio ideju nove društvene strukture koju je nazvao kontribucionizmom. Ona predstavlja suprotnost tihom i neumornom ratu ekonomskog ropstva, toliko lukavo pletenom da ga većina nije niti svjesna. Već godinama Michael Tellinger uključen je u mnoge vrlo eksponirane pravne postupke protiv nezakonitog djelovanja banaka. Iz svojih iskustava izveo je ideju o globalnom društvu bez novca koje je vođeno principima zajedništva. U knjizi Ubuntu opisao je konkretne korake koje je moguće napraviti u tom smjeru, u smjeru kontribucionizma. O tome bi se moglo porazgovarati i ovdje, na rubu znanosti. Sve vas pozdravljam. Danas razgovaramo ne po prvi put sa Markom Tellingerom, autorom knjige i ideje o društvenom pokretu zvanom Ubuntu. Dobar dan.
Good morning.
Što je Ubuntu?
Well, thanks for asking that. And the good thing is that the Ubuntu book is now also available in Croatian. So people in Croatia can actually find it out about Ubuntu in their own language. But in essence, Ubuntu is an ancient African philosophy. That means unity within community. That's probably the best definition I've come up with. It's not easy to describe Ubuntu because it is truly a philosophy on life, on sharing, on community, on prosperity, everything together. But the one of the many descriptions that it gets is I am who I am because who we all are in our community. And I came up with a word Ubuntu for Ubuntu, a description in the 21st century, which I call contributionism, to describe Ubuntu in its original form. And contributionism means where we all contribute our talents and skills for the greatest benefit of everyone in our community.
Prije nego što ste počeli osmišljavati Ubuntu, počeli ste kroz svoje knjige proučavati veze između drevne povijesti i situacije u kojoj svijet danas, neki tu situaciju opisuju kao moderno ropstvo. Danas se već dosta i govori o pitanju stvaranja novca, što je to novac uopće, postoji li kao takav, što su sve ideje koje su do prije 10 godina bile daleko izvan očiju javnosti. Naravno, takva razmišljanja često se etiketiraju na razne načine, recimo jedna od etikete je teorija urote, što je naravno samo etiketa koju čovjek dobiva umjesto odgovora. Kakva je vaša zapravo vizija povijesti i utjecaja povijesti na svijet kakav je danas?
Yeah, when I was writing Slave Species of God and I was really looking deeply into the origins of humankind and who we are, where we come from, why we are here, looking at all the ancient texts and as much information as I could, it became very clear to me that humanity existed without money for much longer than we've existed with money. So I started thinking, well, hold on, this doesn't make any sense because all of us are born into a money society. We're born into capitalism, we're born into communism, we're born into some sort of system that is driven by money because we can't imagine a world without money. So I started thinking, well, that's not really true, is it? Because if people existed without money for thousands and thousands of years, how did they survive? How did they buy things? How did they get things if there was no money? And I started looking at a philosophy or a theory of what would happen if you took money out of the system. If you just removed money, how would things work? And to my surprise, I started finding that the more you remove money from the system, the easier and simpler things get. The easier it is for us to survive, the easier it is for us to coexist, to share ideas, to share knowledge and information and create inventions without them being hidden or masked or stolen by companies. And I realized that that's actually the way it should be, that money is just a tool of enslavement that was imposed on humanity at some specific time in our history. And that's exactly what I found out. I found out that there was a very specific point in human history that money was introduced maliciously and cunningly by design as a tool of enslavement of the human race.
Kako je podrijetlo, to jest kad su nastale te kraljevske krvne loze koje kontroliraju svijet i danas, kako neki kažu, kad je uopće sve to počelo?
My research points towards the Sumerian texts that give us some indication of where this control of humanity began. And there are several Sumerian texts known as the King's Lists. And two of the King's Lists specifically speak about the creation of the royal bloodlines and then the creation of money. And they tell us that there was a time in human history when kingdom was lowered to earth from heaven, and the first kings and priest kings were appointed by the gods. So it seems to me that the royal bloodlines were imposed on humanity, and certain people were chosen to be the first kings, to be the representatives of the gods or the Anunnaki on planet Earth. They were appointed by the gods and the Anunnaki, if you want to call them that, and they were given knowledge and weapons and knowledge of alchemy and sorcery to be able to control humanity, because they needed some tools and powers, otherwise nobody would listen to them, right? Say, well, I'm your new king, you better listen to me. Say, really? I don't think so. Go away. So clearly the royal bloodlines must have been imposed under some sort of threat of violence against the people. If you don't do what I tell you, I will kill you, or I will smite you, or I will, you know, burn your house down or whatever. And so this is a very important moment in human history, and this is how far back we can trace the current bloodlines, the royal bloodlines that are still in the world today, can be traced back to these ancient times that the Sumerian texts talk about. And these first priest kings and royal bloodlines became the first bankers, and the banks were the temples. So bank and temple are synonymous with control of humanity and money. So what these first priest kings did is they introduced this thing called money as a form of control. And then they became the bankers, the temples were the banks, and this is how they started to control the people. They owned all the land. The people had to pay them taxes to live on the land and listen and obey their rules and their command. It's a complete hijacking of the human race in ancient times by these so-called royal bloodlines. And this is where we see the origins of money and the royal bloodlines that have kept and held onto the control of the creation of money as a tool of enslavement, which still continues today.
Pod kojim imenima i organizacijama su danas skrivene te krvne loze? Zbog čega ih više ne doživljavamo u tolikoj mjeri kao što smo ih doživljavali nekad?
Well, we are very aware of the bloodlines. It's the royalty on planet Earth, you know, the Queen of England, the Queen of Holland, the Dutch royalty, the German royalty, the Anglo-Saxon empire that has pretty much taken control of our planet. And they are in cahoots with all the governments of the world. They impose themselves on the governments. They have pretty much invaded the whole planet. And if they haven't invaded it yet, there's probably a reason for it, and they will invade it when they want to invade it, because they've developed techniques and methodology that has pretty much given them control of the whole planet. So the bloodlines are very quietly working behind the scenes, but they're using the banking institutions as the front. So nobody is aware of the fact that it's the kings and the queens and the royalty of the world that is actually in control of what's going on here. But there again lies a possible twist of what could be going on, because the control must come from some higher order and not necessarily from the bloodlines. So it seems that we may still be under control of some extraterrestrials that have taken control of our planet a long time ago and are using the bloodlines and the people and the financial systems to keep humanity enslaved in such a spectacular way that the majority of the people are just simply not even aware of it. You know, then you look at the royalty worship. I mean, in England, it's crazy. The people actually worship the royalty. Why? I don't understand why people would behave like that. Mm-hmm. You know, some woman called the Queen owns all the land, owns half the world, and people worship her. And she's not doing anything for the people. She's just abusing the people, and the government is abusing the people, and people still come and worship them. It shows you that the slavery system has been imposed so well that the slaves have become their own prison wardens.
Objasnite nam ideju koju razlažete u svojoj knjizi Ubuntu, da su zapravo, to možda nije ideja, već činjenica, da su sve države, ministarstva i gradovi svijeta u stvari korporacije. Kako se to može dokazati?
Well, it's very simple to find out about whether your country is registered as a corporation, because that's what's happened to the whole world. Every country, every city, every state, every province, every county, everything in our lives, without us realizing it, has been turned into a corporation. We are little corporations. We have a birth certificate. So we are the property of someone else. If you have a certificate, get given a certificate at birth, it means you belong to somebody. You're the property of somebody who's laid claim to you. That's why there's a certificate issued in your name. And you belong to the corporation called Croatia. I belong to the corporation called the Republic of South Africa. And this is just spectacular deception that's been imposed on humanity. People just are not aware of this. And once they wake up and realize what's going on, it's a lot easier to figure out what we have to do to get ourselves out of this mess. But all you got to do is go onto the website of the Securities Exchange in the USA, in Washington, D.C., and there you see all the names of the registered countries as corporations. There's also Brad and Dunn's, what are they called again? Brad... Dun and Bradstreet, that have a list of all the countries and cities and provinces as corporations. City of Cape Town is traded as Municipality of Cape Town, I think, or something. But you can get all these details and information there. So it is not hidden. It's out there. But people don't go looking for it because they don't suspect such a crime to be committed against us right in front of our eyes. And this is how the elite have been getting away with this for so many hundreds and thousands of years. Because people don't expect them to be committing crimes against the people. Because we appoint our leaders as our servants. Most of us think that when we go voting in the elections, we vote for our president and our prime ministers and our leaders to be the servants, to serve the people. But that's not what really happens. We just think we are electing the leaders. Our leaders are not elected, they are selected for us, and we get given a choice of a few selected candidates, and then we select one of the lesser evils, but they all end up they all end up answering to the same authority, and that authority is the authority that controls the money and is connected to the royal bloodlines.
Taj Dun & Bradstreet daje određeni broj koji se zove DUNS. DUNS broj, to je neka vrsta jedinstvenog svjetskog poreznog broja. I čak jasno, ispred svih tih raznih institucija, državnih, ministarstava, gradova, piše ponekad trgovačko društvo, ponekad tvrtka. I očito je da su sve te, kako mi zamišljamo, državne, nacionalne institucije, zapravo korporacije. Manje očigledno da su i ljudi pretvoreni u korporacije. Spomenuli ste već matični list, tu je onda i razlika između velikih slova na dokumentima. Tako se pišu imena korporacija, dok se imena ljudi pišu sa velikim slovom početnim, ostalo malim slovima. Objasnite nam tu činjenicu da su ljudi, postojući fiktivne takozvane osobe, odnosno pravni entiteti, ušli u jedan sustav koji u stvari ne razumiju, ne znaju da su mu dio, i zapravo svi mi kao živa bića preuzimamo obaveze tih takozvanih pravnih osoba u koje smo pretvoreni sa rođenjem, pomoću tih matičnih listova i slično.
Well, people often refer to, or people are referred to by the current system, the corporate system, as a legal fiction. So you're a piece of paper. Your birth certificate and your ID document and all the papers associated with you as a living, breathing human being are turned into pieces of paper. And you have to present an ID document when you get stopped behind authority. Well, have you got any identification? Yes, here, I am the identification. I'm standing in front of you, but that's not good enough. You have to present a piece of paper to tell them that this is you. And this is how there you can start seeing the deception. Why should you need any identification when you're standing right in front of the person of authority? And this is how they've turned us into obedient slaves. And we present our ID documents, which are the legal fiction of the living, breathing human being. And this is what gets used in the courts. This is what gets used in the legal system, and and given various names, like a person is also not a living, breathing human being, and so it goes. So when people start finding this out, it's a big shock to the system, and they realize that they know nothing, or we know nothing, about how we've been manipulated and lied to and abused. And once again, once you get over the shock and you realize that this is much worse than you ever imagined, then you start dealing with what do we do about this. And this is where the Ubuntu movement comes in.
Prije nego što se posvetimo ideji Ubuntu, popričamo još o novcu. Što je to hram krune kojeg spominjete u knjizi? Nikad ga se inače u javnosti baš ne spominje kad se priča o novcu, ali ta institucija, barem prema vašim riječima, za globalne tokove novca i stvaranje novca vrlo važna, ako ne i najvažnija.
Well, the Crown Temple is really the main, I suppose you can call, building or institution in the City of London. The City of London is not the town of London or the City of London town as we know it today. City of London is a square mile in the heart of London, from where the global banking and financial systems are controlled. And the Crown Temple is at the heart of this piece of land where the global money supply and the global money control is manipulated and controlled from, or is the headquarters of this bloodline that controls the supply of money to the world. And the City of London with the Crown Temple is one of the three independent city-states that are inside countries that operate as independent states within existing countries. And the Crown Temple, the City of London, controls the money. The Washington DC in the USA controls the law and the legal systems, and the Vatican City controls religion. And between those three, they pretty much control global activity. They control the media, they control the money supply, they control the military, and it controls all the activities of this planet. And people aren't aware of the fact that we have these independent states inside our countries. Everybody is aware of Vatican City, but they don't really know what it means. And Washington DC, they don't really know what it means. So it's just another deception. When you hear that, for example, in the South African War of 1900, 1899 to 1902, when the British Empire was sent to secure that part of the world, Southern Africa, for the crown, people think that it's for the crown, it's for the queen. No, it's got nothing to do with the queen, actually. It's got everything to do with securing that part of the world for the Crown Temple, the people that control the money and the gold, specifically the gold. Remember that the global supply, the global control, is inextricably connected to gold, as we discussed in other programs, and our obsession with gold. So this is so deeply convoluted for thousands of years, and the control over humanity is not just a few decades or a few hundred years old. It goes back thousands of years, and the Crown Temple is right at the heart of this.
Evo, sjedimo ovdje lijepi dan na otoku u prirodi i dok čovjek ovako uživa, može se zapitati, postoji li zaista neki pravi dokaz da smo izloženi nekakvom skrovitom djelovanju koje možda uopće ne razumijemo?
Well, many people will be aware of the fact that humanity is under attack. We're under attack by so many different ways, but one of the best and simplest ways to describe it are the chemtrails that are happening right above us right now. You know, for people that are not aware of this, you know, wake up. These are not clouds. These are not vapor trails behind airplanes. These are poisonous chemical substances that are being sprayed into our skies. And on this beautiful island of Brač is today been completely under attack. They have not stopped spraying chemtrails on us since early this morning. There are toxins and chemicals and microscopic organisms and viruses and bacteria in there that are specifically put in there to do the planet harm and to create certain conditions, biological and ecological conditions, that suppress humanity, that poison our land, poison our water, poison our bodies, poison the air. We are under full-blown attack. You know, Third World War has begun. It's just the people are not aware of it, and the war is coming down from the sky.
Očito je da se pojedinac teško može konfrontirati s tom nevidljivom silom, s tom nevidljivom moći. Koja je glavna ideja iza Ubuntu i kontribucionizma po tom pitanju? Kako bi se uopće moglo potaknuti ljude da iskorače iz starog sustava i počnu stvarati neki još uvijek nepoznati novi.
Well, first of all, we have to realize that we are the 99.99%. We, the people of the world, are the majority, by far the large majority. And we're being controlled and manipulated by a small number of individuals. Now, that clearly must give us a sense of confidence that we can change things in our own favor. And the Ubuntu movement is not about confronting anyone or fighting anyone or any violent activities. Those days are over. We're moving into higher consciousness. We're moving into unity consciousness, embracing the fact that we need to unite humanity from our deeply divided separation that has been imposed on humanity. Remember, the whole divide and conquer principle has been imposed on humanity. So we've been divided and separated so that we don't trust each other, and then we are turned against each other in situations of war and conflict that are created by the banking institutions and those that control money, because that's how they create, keep us in an ever perpetual state of division and conflict, and that's how they can keep control of humanity. So those days of conflict and violence are over. We need to start finding a new way. And the whole Ubuntu philosophy is exactly that, is to find a new way ahead, not to confront the old or create any violent situations. And to do that, we have to first understand what has happened in the past, what we should not be doing, and then find a new way forward. And that's what we propose very simply by firstly telling people about the money system, that we can no longer live in a world with money. So how do we move from a world with money towards a world without money? It's not a simple step. You can't go from zero to hero. You have to go through a few processes. The other thing is that we realized very soon that when you start working in communities and creating community projects in communities that will help uplift and benefit the community, that is not always a final solution. Because the moment your community or the projects that you've created become a threat to the establishment, they will send the men with guns to shut you down. So I realize that we have to utilize the political arena at the same time. Not because we want to go into politics and we want to become dirty and corrupt and disgusting like the political system is, but by going in and changing the system into a reputable, honorable, and a respectful part of human society that actually serves the people. Because at the moment, politics is destroying our lives, and by sitting on the fence or ignoring it is not going to solve the problem. So I realized that we have to embrace politics, get in there, and become a virus of consciousness that actually changes the political arena in the favor of humanity. So the Ubuntu movement is structured from community projects, creating a large number of community projects that benefit the people in their communities. Not corporations, not their municipalities, and not the governments, the people in their communities. And then having a political party that represents those values, those principles, and the manifesto that the people can then go and vote for on a political level. And this is a very critical thing for people to digest, is that it's a top-down and a bottom-up approach that we've taken with the Ubuntu movement.
Ubuntu bi prema vašoj knjizi trebao krenuti od malih ruralnih naselja i tu se naravno javlja potpuno nova perspektiva sati radnog vremena koja se meni osobno vrlo sviđa jer mnogo se može napraviti ako svaki čovjek pridonese samo 3 sata radnog vremena za zajednicu tjedno. To je zanimljiva matematika jer mnogi će se složiti da je ovih današnjih 8 sati dnevno puno i previše jer čovjeku praktički ništa ne ostaje vremena za vlastiti život preko tjedna.
We explain to people that competition is not good. Competition is bad. Competition is the worst thing that's ever been imposed on humanity. And we've all been brought into this world thinking that competition is good. Without competition, there'd be no progress, there'd be no invention. People would be lazy, that nothing would ever happen without competition. That is not true. Competition brings forward and to the surface all the ugly aspects of humanity. It brings the aspect of control, of the pyramid hierarchical structure, of a few controlling everything while the rest of the people are doing all the work. And competition allows companies and governments to hide knowledge and information, like the cure for disease and free energy and free electricity and so forth. So with the Ubuntu movement, first thing we do is tell people that we're no longer going to compete. we're going to cooperate. We're going to work together. We're going to cooperate and collaborate so that we do everything together for the benefit of the people. We'll grow the food, we'll create the technology, we'll create, design new furniture and homes, and create cures for all disease. And anything we decide to do as a community, we will do. Why? Because we can, and we've decided to do that. We're not going to do anything and then keep it for a group of the people of our community while we exploit the rest of the community. That is what we're turning around. So, very critical first point of departure. Now, to unite communities and start communities working in a group of community projects is not that easy in a city situation. So, the big cities are probably going to be left to learn from the small towns. So, our philosophy is to implement this philosophy of Ubuntu in the small towns and villages where it is a lot easier to reach all the people, to share the philosophy of sharing and cooperating and collaborating and get consensus from the people, and then take it to a political level and the next election go vote for this new philosophy of ours. A plan of action is to identify a diverse number of community projects, from recycling, from a bakery, bread, milk, cheese, wood factory, metal factory, fish farming, whatever you can imagine, making shoes, etc., engineering, technology, a diverse number of community projects. Each community project is maintained and looked after by a master artisan, a master baker, a master engineer, or a master scientist, or a master food grower, together with a project manager on behalf of the community. And we create three times as much as what we need. Now, to do this, we need something to unify the people. And this is where the electricity comes in. This is a critical part of the plan of action. One of the things we plan to do with the Ubuntu Party when we win the election in our town or community, the first thing we do is we implement our own electricity supply. And that is really important, because that electricity supply becomes free to everyone. Everyone gets uncapped electricity, like we get uncapped Wi-Fi today, because it's our electricity. We put the systems in, and once we've paid for it, the electricity belongs to us. So we no longer have to pay for it on a monthly basis. And that electricity provides the electricity for all the community projects, and it's free to everyone in the town under one condition. If they contribute 3 hours a week towards one of those community projects, just like you said. 3 hours a week is all it takes to create a community of abundance. And if you have a town of 5,000 people, each one contributing 3 hours a week, that's 15,000 hours a week we are contributing towards our community. And you will know very quickly that 15,000 hours a week turns your town into a powerful labor force. No government, no municipality, no corporation or company can compete with 15,000 hours a week, because we're doing it together and we're doing it for free for the benefit of our community. And that starts to change everything in people's minds, their perception, how they see money interacting and money working. And it's a very quick step towards transitioning from the current system into a new Ubuntu contributionism system. The other critical thing about this is that it's a very simple transitional step. Everybody can afford 3 hours a week. You don't need to leave your job or give up anything, because everyone can afford 3 hours a week. That means that we can transition from the current system into a contributionism system very smoothly. And before you know it, you're getting everything for free. Your bread and milk and electricity and furniture and clothing, everything for free, because you're participating in the community projects. And the extra money we make from the community projects gets distributed among the people in our town. So very soon you'll say, well, why do I still work? Why do I still keep this job? I don't need that job, because I'm actually getting more money from the community projects in my town than I'm getting from my job. And this is how we can very quickly transition from capitalism into contributionism and start getting rid of money completely.
Kako zamišljate koordinaciju zajednice Ubuntu? Spominje se nešto nalik nekakvom vijeću staraca, pa čak i da bi trebalo biti utemeljeno na principima svete geometrije. Naravno, tradicionalno u starim zajednicama vijeća staraca nisu donosila nikakve zakone, već su o svakoj situaciji raspravljali od nule na temelju zdravog razuma, osjećaja za pravdu. Kako tu pragmatiku vidite u sklopu svojih ideja kako izgraditi način života zvan Ubuntu?
First of all, one of the common questions is, oh, is this a moneyless society? Is this a lawless society? Who's going to make the laws and the rules? And the answer is the people make the laws and the rules in their own community. The whole plan is to deconstruct government, decentralize government, so that people run and rule themselves in their own communities, like the old city-states in some way, like the city of Rome and so forth, where we had city-states, where people start to look after themselves and make their own laws for their own communities. But it's not just a lawless society where anyone can make any laws. Obviously, we need to have some structure and we need to have guidance. And for this purpose, we look to nature and we look to what we refer to as sacred geometry. Now, sacred geometry has encoded in it all the laws of nature that we find around ourselves. And we often, as human beings, find ourselves operating outside of the laws of nature, outside of the sacred geometry. And this is why we find ourselves in conflict with all the things around us, in conflict with nature around us. So we need to start embracing and resonating with the sacred geometry around us and the whole structure for a guidance and suggestions for what the community should be doing will fall on the Council of Elders. It's a tribal council. All ancient people used to have a tribal council, a Council of Elders. And that doesn't mean you have to be old to be on the Council of Elders. You have to be wise, and you have to be trusted, and you have to be respected. So in terms of the sacred geometry principle, the Council of Elders we propose should consist of 13 people, 12 around one, just like the Christ consciousness philosophy. People will know what I mean if they've studied this. 12 around one, like the 12 disciples around Christ, and many things in nature are structured along these simple sacred geometric principles. And this will really serve our communities very, very well and very simply. And the council's task is there to guide and advise the people and look after the interests of the community, not after the interests of individuals at the expense of everybody else. And therefore, the appointment to the Council of Elders will be an open voting system. So everybody puts their name down and says, I, Michael Tellinger, vote for John Smith to be on the Council of Elders. Now, if everybody knows that John Smith is a crook and a thief and a liar, then they'll say, Michael, why are you voting for John Smith to be on the Council of Elders? So it exposes me as having ulterior motives. So it's a very simple way to control who we appoint to the Council of Elders. They have to be trusted, respected, and honored by the people in their community to make the best decisions for the whole community.
Kako vidite ulogu obrazovanja u suvremenom svijetu i naravno kako vidite ulogu nekog budućeg obrazovanja u Ubuntu, neću reći sustavu, nego ne sustavu?
Yeah, Ubuntu way of life. Yes. The education aspect of an Ubuntu contributionism community is critical. It is ultimately the foundation of our future society. The way that education happens today has got nothing to do with teaching our children and ourselves as adults any skills for life, any way to survive. The education system as we have it today was very cleverly and maliciously put together by the banking families. Specifically, the Rockefellers and the Carnegies were behind this current education system. They've planned this 200 years ago already. This has been in the making and brought to us as a new education system. Today, it's become an indoctrination, mind-numbing, slavery system that takes our children away from their parents for 12 years of their lives and fills their head with lies, with indoctrination, and programs them to fear authority, to automatically respect authority and obey authority without questioning anything. So it turns our children into a future obedient labor force. That's it. We learn all these subjects at school that have got nothing to do with skills for life or being able to survive. But what we do when we leave school is we get a certificate, right? It's a piece of paper. A piece of paper that does nothing. And now we feel that we can go looking for a job with a certificate. We have this idea that we'll get a job because we've gone to school. And what is a job? A job is a slavery system. Job means slave. Every time a politician says we're going to create 1 million more jobs, they're telling us they're going to create 1 million more slaves. Because when you've been taken in as a slave into a job, when this corporation no longer needs you, they throw you out. The corporation carries on existing, but the people keep dying because they've been thrown out and discarded by the corporation. This is why the corporate structure is so dangerous to humanity, is so dangerous to living, breathing human beings, because the corporate structure system is inhumane. It is not of human origin. And this is why we need to get away from it, stop competing and start cooperating. And the new education system in Ubuntu communities is a simple, elegant system that teaches all of us, all of our children, from the youngest of ages, the skills for life that we need to survive, to create, to invent, to do whatever we feel or our hearts desire that comes from our own abilities to create and to contribute towards our society. Now, the many community projects that we put in place, and there will be many, they'll keep growing and growing and growing, in technology, in arts, culture, agriculture, science, any area that you can imagine. We'll have master teachers, masters of their specific field, that will become the teachers. You can't call yourself a teacher unless you are a master of what it is that you do. How can you call yourself a teacher teaching people how to bake bread if you don't know how to bake bread? So if I'm going to send my child to learn how to bake bread, I want them to go to a master baker and learn that skill from the master baker. If I want to teach my child how to build a bridge, I send my child to an engineer, master in engineering, to learn how to build a bridge. And so it goes, how to create free electricity, how to learn about chemicals and learn about space and astronomy and archaeology. All these areas will be covered by master teachers who then become the teachers in our community. So from the earliest of age, we will not have classrooms or have the needs for classrooms, because by the time you are 16 years old in an Ubuntu community, you will know how to build a bridge, how to create electricity, how to bake bread, how to make cheese, how to work with wood and metal. You'll know everything about the stars and the planets. You don't need to sit in a classroom and learn that from a textbook. So that is how I see an evolution into a whole new education system, that by the time you're 16 years old, you'll know more than all the professors in the world combined.
Nekako je lakše zamisliti Ubuntu u manjim zajednicama. Pravi izazov predstavljaju veliki gradovi u kojima živi 1 milijun, 2 milijuna, 6, 10 milijuna stanovnika, u kojima se ljudi u potpuno ovisničkom odnosu i prema infrastrukturi, znači struji, vodi, prema sustavu kao takvom u cjelini, nemaju vlastitu zemlju koju bismo mogli znači, uzgajati hranu. Kako transferirati Ubuntu u te iznimno strukturirane i potpuno ovisničke cjeline koje zovemo gradovi?
Yeah, this is a really important question and a very important way for people to start understanding and molding their personal perception and understanding of Ubuntu and contributionism and how we're going to transition from the current system into this new system of abundance. And I also must just remind you and the listeners that an Ubuntu contributionism system is not a self-sustaining community. We are creating communities of abundance. We create much more than what we need, so we can share it with all our neighboring communities. In the beginning, we'll be selling it to our neighboring communities, because that's how we're going to make money to create new community projects and how we create new systems that create components for community projects, so eventually we're not dependent on anything from outside of our community. But in essence, we go from creating an abundance, creating at least 3 times as much as what we need, so that we can use the 1/3 for ourselves and the other 2/3 is available to selling to outside communities. And this is how the contributionism system destroys capitalism wherever it finds it, because capitalism can never compete with this contributionism system. And the people around us will automatically want to adopt a contributionist system, because they'll see all the people in our community living in paradise, having everything available to them for free, free electricity, free food, free everything. So they'll also want to do this. And so we're not going to have to impose this on anyone. It'll happen automatically and naturally, very, very quickly, once we have the first contributionist model in place.
And then what will happen is it'll start having an effect on the big cities and the big metropolitan areas where people really live, you know, squeezed together like sardines in a can. They come there looking for a job, looking for a better life, and find themselves trapped in a system that they cannot escape. Most people in the city don't live there by choice. They live there because they were offered a job, or they thought they were going to get a job, and they got a much worse job than they were hoping to get. And this is the problem. And they can't just give up their job and move into a small town, because there's no job for them in a small town. And this is where, in the transitional phase as well, the People's Bank could play a critical role in releasing people from the cities. So on a national level, if we could implement a People's Bank that issues money for the people, by the people, tax-free and interest-free, and this money is used to set up public works and community projects in every town or city or small village, that means that anyone from the city can go back to their town or village where they came from or wherever they want to go, and there'll always be something for them to do. If they want to start a bakery, the money will be provided by the People's Bank, because that's the job of a People's Bank. If you want to start a music school, the money will be provided by a People's Bank. People's Bank won't provide money for people to buy houses and cars. It provides money for infrastructure, for creating abundance for the people in their communities. So this is just a very quick step to allow people to think outside the box and say, wow, a People's Bank will release the people from the cities to go live wherever they want, as long as their intentions are to benefit the whole community, not just to enrich themselves at the expense of the rest of the people. The other thing is, once we win a small town like this with the Ubuntu party, and we start to implement these community projects, this free supply of everything to the people, many people in the towns and cities have families and friends that live in towns and small towns and communities. Many people have a cottage out in the country, and they go away for a long weekend, and they can't wait for the long weekend to escape to the country and go stay in their beautiful cottage by the river or in the mountains and have 4 days of sanity, and then they go back to the craziness of the city. So what will start happening is the people start moving from the city to the small towns and seeing how everyone there has everything they need. And they too, when they go there, all they have to do is work for 3 hours, and suddenly they've got access to everything they need in that community. And they, at some stage, they're going to say, well, why am I going back to the city? Why am I going back to a job to work like a slave? When I come here for the long weekend, everything is available for free. All I've done is work for 3 hours, and I've learned new skills. And so this, how I believe, will be one of the things. There'll be many other ways that the cities will become depopulated, but this is possibly one of the ways that it'll start happening. But at the same time, the people in the cities may organize themselves in suburbs, in smaller parts and sections of the city. So they start working like small communities and small towns that make up the suburbs, that make up the big cities, and implement the same philosophy. Provide their own electricity supply, everybody gets free electricity in that suburb, and then they create community projects in that suburb that then benefits everybody in that community. Once the model has been set up, it's then probably not going to be very difficult to implement that model wherever you go in the world.
Dugoročno gledano, što ćete raditi s tim silnim obiljem koje princip Ubuntu-a stvara?
Remember that everything we do in our communities is done with a very good and specific plan. So we create at least 3 times as much as what we need for our community. So we know how much is going to be distributed to everyone, and there's no argument about that. But we're not always going to be able to sell everything we grow and manufacture or produce. So what are we going to do with all the extra stuff? We're going to put it into Ubuntu warehouses. Think of it as a Walmart, but a Walmart of the people. And these Ubuntu warehouses will be available for anyone else to come and buy their stuff. But they'll be able to buy it for much cheaper than they can buy in any supermarket at the moment, because we'll be putting it in there virtually for free, because we're creating it for free. Any one of the people in our community will get some sort of an electronic card as an Ubuntu community member that allows you to go to this warehouse and take whatever is allocated to you based on the big plan. And there's always going to be too much stuff. So you will never run out of stuff. But what we'll do by doing this is basically creating a new alternative, a new supply chain of food, a new supply chain of technology and furniture and clothing and anything we do in our community projects, away from the current corporate structure and the corporate control that keeps it away from the people. People will be able to access it very, very cheaply and very easily. Not only that, but what we've actually also done is created a new alternative currency system. That card that you have becomes a new currency that cannot be destroyed by the Rothschild banking empire. They can't close your bank account. They can't stop you from getting your food or your clothes or your technology because it's in our Ubuntu warehouses. We made it. No one can take it away. And this is the major masterstroke that I think when people see this, they go, oh my goodness, I see where you're going with this. This is so simple. So in a very, very short period of time, we can create an alternative supply of food and everything we need and create an alternative currency system with our Ubuntu cards. Remember, you can take that card and you can fly to Italy and go visit your friend in Rome and go report to the Ubuntu office there in the Ubuntu community and say, hi, I'm Michael, I'm here. They say, hey, Michael, swipe your card, welcome. This week we need some, the chemical engineers are developing a new material over there, please go report at this time. For 3 hours, work with the chemical engineers, go help them out, and you'll go work, do your 3 hours, and then you got access to all the things in the Ubuntu warehouse for the whole week. That's how simple it is. So we've created not just a local, but an international currency that cannot be collapsed by the Rothschild Empire.
Za kraj, imate li neku, kako bismo to rekli, eksperimentalnu potvrdu da vaša ideja radi u praksi? Naravno, teško imati eksperimentalnu potvrdu za nešto što zahtjeva razvijeni sustav koji se ne može sagledavati parcijalno, ali ipak imate li kakvih naznaka, nekakvih povratnih informacija na tu temu?
This is a frequently asked question. Do you have any examples of a working Ubuntu community? And the answer is no. Because if we had an example of a working Ubuntu community, it will already be affecting the world. It will be destroying capitalism everywhere. We'll have Ubuntu towns springing up all over the world, because this is not an idea that is confined by countries or borders. This is an idea that goes right across the planet. It's a philosophy that resonates in people's hearts and that they want to implement themselves. So the only real examples of an Ubuntu philosophy is when we look back at ancient times, when people lived in their communities. They didn't have money and they didn't have jails. And when the European settlers or invaders arrived 500 years ago to settle the whole planet and colonize the whole planet, they found all ancient cultures didn't have jails and they didn't have money. They implemented money and they built jails, and the rest is history. So basically we can look at ancient cultures for guidance on how to structure this Ubuntu community and then implement it into the modern society, and this is where I call it contributionism.
Michael, hvala na gostovanju i do neke sljedeće prilike, doviđenja. Naravno, sve najbolje sa Ubuntu pogradom i sa svim izborima lokalne ili globalne razine na kojima se mislite kandidirati sa svojom strankom zvanom Ubuntu. Doviđenja.
Thank you very much for talking to me.